Oh, we've gotten quiet again, like it's church. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Heritage Foundation. I'm John Hilbolt, Director of Lectures and Seminars. We're pleased everyone can join us here in our Douglas and Sarah Allison Auditorium. We, of course, welcome those who join us on each occasion via the internet at our heritage.org website. We remind everyone in-house now is a good time to check cell phones and pagers to see that they've been turned off. And we remind our internet viewers on each occasion, questions can be submitted to our speaker addressed via email to speaker@heritage.org. Hosting our program this morning is Dr. Tim Kane. Dr. Kane is our director of the Center for International Trade and Economics here at Heritage. Prior to joining the foundation, he was a senior economist at the Joint Economic Committee, was a professor of economics at Occidental College and San Diego State University, and served as an intelligence officer with the U.S. Air Force. Next week, one of his department's key projects, the 2007 Index for Economic Freedom, will be issued. He'll be on that launch tour. And as I've told our guest, we like to make sure we put our books on top of their books, so you have two opportunities to discuss books here. Dr. Kane was a graduate of the Air Force Academy. He received his PhD in economics from the University of California at San Diego. Tim, I'll turn it over to you now.
Welcome, everyone, to the Heritage Foundation. I have the unique honor of introducing a rock star. There's been a flood of interest for Mark Steyn's appearance today, and he has written a fantastic book. I imagine most of you have read it. It's actually been a little bit difficult to actually get space at this event today because we've had so many requests, and of course Mark will be available afterwards. It's a little bit humbling when you have so many fans that I'm the one that actually gets to do the introduction, Mark, so I hope I can live up to it. I have to say that Mark is, you know, he's everywhere, right? He's been blogging, he's been hosting radio shows, he's just a brilliant writer, but he's one of these writers, and if you've read this book you understand it, that he makes you angry. And if you don't agree with him, certainly he'll make you angry because he takes strong stands. If you do agree with him, he makes you angry because you think, why did God give so much talent to him when I've been struggling for so long to write well? And I was furious reading this book because it just flows so well. So it really is just fantastic to have you here, and we're glad. By way of introduction, I looked at the Wikipedia entry for your bio. I know there's one inside the jacket cover and there's your official bio, but I thought this was interesting nonetheless. Conservative Canadian journalist, columnist, and film and theater critic. And of course, we've brought you here for your opinion on King Kong. That's the main issue. He's actually a columnist. Mark Steyn is a columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times, the New York Sun, the Washington Times, the Orange County Register, National Review. He's written extensively for the Atlantic Monthly and is a regular there, the New Criterion, Maclean's, the Australian. I could go on and on. And I thought it was worth running through this list to show you how prolific Mark is and how well-regarded he is with regular columns on multiple continents. Mark was born in Toronto, resides in New Hampshire, and has some serious things to say in this book about the future for Europe, the future for America, and of course the title of the book, America Alone, feels more and more like that's true. Not necessarily alone by choice, but alone due to a number of circumstances that are helping shape the world we move into. And I know a big part of Mark's talk will be demographics, and I want to say off the hand, my wife and I just had our fourth child, so it's not our fault, Mark. There are problems. In Europe. There are problems in America, and working on the Index of Economic Freedom has made it more clear than ever to me that the welfare state is a problem. As an economist, I understand incentives drive everything, and when people don't have the right incentives to work hard, to be productive, to think independently and critically for their own security and the security of their children, if they have children, then they reach the wrong conclusions. And thank God we have Mark Steyn to help remind us what the right conclusions are. With that, please join me in welcoming Mark Steyn to speak to us today.
Thanks very much for that warm introduction. And I know you said it was difficult, but you pitched it just right. I gave a speech in 2005 out in California. And the guy did this fantastic introduction, and he quoted all my best lines from the 1990s when I was a lot funnier, because we were just, we spent the decade just making Clinton sex jokes, basically. And this guy basically reprised some of his favorite lines from my columns, and I began to notice that actually there weren't any favorite lines from after 2001. They were all from back in the 90s when things were a lot funnier. He mentioned that I'd written a column about Monica's dress, the conceit being that I was interviewing the dress after it had had entered the witness protection program, had reconstructive surgery, and was living as a pair of curtains in Idaho. I was getting big laughs with this bit from my column, but then I was in the odd, I was on the Laura Ingraham show just now, and following these hilarious clips she had of Robert C. Byrd, and I said to Laura, I don't want to follow Robert C. Byrd as my warm-up act again. And I felt listening to my reprises of my greatest hits in this introduction that I didn't want to follow myself again. It was like my dad went to see Elvis in Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto in 1956, and they had this Irish tenor who came on first and who sang "I'll Take You Home Again, Kathleen" and "Roses of Picardy," and you couldn't hear a word. Everyone was just baying for Elvis. And I felt listening to my greatest hits from the 90s and then coming on and talking about the end of the world, that they'd had Elvis on first and I was the loser Irish tenor nobody wanted to hear. So anyway, it is a great pleasure to be here to depress the hell out of you. Let me say first of all why I wrote my book. I wrote it for two reasons, and the pompous reason was to sort of change the way we think about the war on terror. Islamic terrorism, as I see it, including nuclear terrorism even, is not the disease but merely a symptom. And it's a symptom of two things: the weakness of the West and a very particular strength of Islam. And tonight the President will speak yet again on Iraq. And it's important to win in Iraq, and it's important to be seen to win. But Iraq is only one front in a broader struggle. And in that broader struggle, we cannot win if we think we can rely solely on the 3rd Infantry Division and the U.S. Marine Corps and a troop surge here and a troop surge there. There's something bigger that is at play here. And the reality is that even if there were no al-Qaeda, no Hezbollah, no President Ahmadinejad, no bombs in Bali and in Madrid and London, we would still be in danger of losing, without a single bomb going off anywhere. Now, how can that be? Radical Islam is a weak enemy. It's militarily, economically, technologically inconsequential. But it thinks it's strong where it counts. It has youth and will. And the Western world, for the most part, has neither. We're showing classic signs of civilizational exhaustion. And that's a very hard thing to buck. I focus on two symptoms in the book: the demographic decline in Europe, Russia, Japan, Canada, and just as important, I think, the signs of loss of will right here in the heart of the superpower. To take that first thing, demography, apart from America, just about every other member of the G8, of NATO, every other second and third tier power has given up having babies. Your four children would make you a very bizarre sight on the streets of most European cities these days. And if you and your wife walked around with those four young children, people would assume you were running a daycare. And in most parts of the world, it would be a government daycare, too. And that in itself is part of the problem. In a lot of those countries, in Russia, France, Germany, Britain, just north of here in the province of Quebec, they've imported large Muslim populations to be the children they never had. These Muslims don't want to hijack planes and fly into tall buildings. But large numbers of them, if not significant majorities, share the aims of the people who want to fly the planes into the tall buildings. That's to say, they want to live under Islamic law, not in Yemen and Pakistan, but in France and in Belgium and in Scandinavia and in Canada and eventually here in the United States too. And they think that what sounds absurd to us, they've got a very good chance of being able to pull off. So I always say to people, you know, if you doubt the thesis of America alone, do what I did. Go to the hospitals in Lyon and Brussels and Vienna and look at who's in the maternity wards. That's the Europe in 20 years' time, if not a little sooner. Or go and stand on, say, the streets of Brussels at 9 o'clock at night after the middle-aged and the elderly are all tucked up at home watching TV. After dark, it's the young people who are on the sidewalks. And the young people who are on the sidewalks in Brussels at 9 o'clock at night are not Flemish or Walloon. So we're witnessing one of the biggest population transformations, biggest and fastest population transformations in history. The civilized world is in steep demographic decline. And that's the big picture of which Iraq and Afghanistan are, in fact, relatively small features. Now, America stands apart from these trends. But America as the guarantor of the planet is a slightly problematic concept for some of us. I had a convention. I like to think the ruddy bloom of late middle age is still on my face. But in fact, I'm old enough to have had a conventionally Britannic education, which is to say I learned about the parts of the map that were painted red and about the great inheritance of the British Empire. And if you've been raised as an old-fashioned imperialist, America being the non-imperial superpower is a kind of hard thing to grapple with. You don't quite understand what the deal is here, that America thinks nothing. You get off the plane, any airport in the planet, and you're assaulted by lousy American movies and lousy American pop songs and lousy American cheeseburgers. But America seems far more tentative about exporting its real values to the world. It sees the planet too often as a kind of useful source of franchise outlets for Starbucks and McDonald's, but it doesn't think of what else it might usefully export to those countries. And I think our enemy look at that and think it's very bizarre. You know, between George W. Bush's compassionate crusaderism and hard right isolationism and sort of sappy left multilateralism, which in practical terms is the same as isolationism. It's just that you get to fly off and have a banquet in a European capital every twice a year. Between that, the jihadist figure that America's heart really isn't into being the global hyperpower. And you can't blame them for that, because if you watch CNN International and the endless parade of senators bleating about exit strategies, you would conclude that too. You know, Iran has been meddling in Iraq now for 3 years, and Iran has no plans for an exit strategy. You can watch Iranian TV 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and you'll never see a single mullah fretting that Iran hasn't got an exit strategy from Iraq. That's only something that American legislators do, not Iranian ones. I want to use a couple of quotations I mentioned en passant in the book, and I think of them a lot as the weeks go by. In 1898, General Kitchener slaughtered the dervishes, who were the kind of jihadists of the day, at Omdurman in the Sudan. We used to read it, learn this when I was at school. We learned about this as a great victory. Today they would teach it as a war crime. Hilaire Belloc summarized the great power's attitude to the natives very pithily. He wrote, "Whatever happens, we have got the Maxim gun and they have not." And the Maxim gun was the state-of-the-art technology of the day. And that's how we think about ourselves. Whatever happens, we have got the Maxim gun and the cruise missile and the Daisy Cutter and the ICBM. And therefore, we cannot lose. Whereas our enemies look at us and say, so what? They've got the Maxim gun, but they're not willing to use it. They fight with one hand tied behind their back as a matter of policy under the most onerous rules of engagement ever known in the history of warfare. If we hole up in a mosque, the enemy's figure, the infidel will worry about pockmarking the walls. If they capture us, they take us to Guantanamo, and every human rights lawyer on the planet and half America's national legislature takes up our cause. So if you've got the Maxim gun, but you're not willing to use it, what advantage is it? And they also figure that they'll have the Maxim gun soon enough. Iran, North Korea, Sudan, Venezuela, Al-Qaeda, Hezbollah, the price of entry to the elite club of the most advanced weapons is dropping very, very quickly. It's a lot lower than it was in 1898. It's a lot lower than it was 30 years ago when you had to be a permanent member of the UN Security Council to be a nuclear power. Here's my second quote, which is about a different kind of weapon. Professor Howard Zinn, you probably know him. He's one of America's lefty academics. I know that only narrows it down to 5 or 6 million, but he's one of the A-listers, the kind of guy, like when he's interviewed on NPR, he's introduced in a very kind of neutral, respectful tone, whereas whenever I'm on NPR, I'm always introduced as strident, extreme conservative. There's sort of health warnings all over me before. he's normal. He's the default position. And in his introduction to one of the apparently endless number of books that Cindy Sheehan produces at bi-monthly intervals, Professor Zinn pens this paean to the plucky underdog, quote, "A box cutter can bring down a tower. A poem can build up a movement. A pamphlet can spark a revolution," unquote. I'm a man of words, so I agree that poems and pamphlets are powerful weapons, and our side could use more of them. But the only reason, quote, "a box cutter can bring down a tower" is because of the particular environment in which those terrorists produced their box cutters on September 11th. If 19 punks with box cutters tried something in the parking lot of a sports bar, they'd have been beaten to a pulp in nothing flat. But the airline cabin is the most advanced model of the modern social democratic state. It's basically the wildest dreams of big government up there in cloud cuckoo land, in which every single decision and procedure is the exclusive province of the authorities. And as we discovered on September 11th, the state's arthritic 1970s hijack procedures weren't really up to the challenge that morning. So if Howard Zinn is right about the awesome power of box cutters, then it's worth asking whether the key institutions of Western civilization are trending closer to the guys in the parking lot of the sports bar or more toward the sedated illusory security of those airline cabins on the morning of September 11th. And I think it's hard not to conclude that, in fact, overall, our society is closer to that sedated, illusory security of the airline cabin. So America faces some very tough arithmetic in the years ahead. It's not difficult to foresee, just say, a decade or two hence, a situation where the Muslim world can effectively count on 3 of the permanent votes of the UN Security Council. That's to say, Russia, on present demographic projections, will be majority Muslim by the year 2050. And according to a report in the Toronto Star just a couple of weeks ago, Russia's army will be majority Muslim by the year 2015, in 8 years' time. That's because basically Muslims are the only guys in the Russian Federation who aren't sort of face down in the vodka, so they're the most reliable source of recruits. But that's going to add an interesting wrinkle, not just to the Chechen War, but to the broader geopolitical scene. I mean, we will be in the situation where if we thought it was fun dealing with a Russia that was communist, a Russia that's Islamist, will be a lot more motivated than it was under Brezhnev and Khrushchev. So the only way you can buck that numerical disadvantage as Russia Islamifies and Europe Islamifies is if you have will and confidence. And that's where Iraq comes in. You know, the world thinks America is bogged down in Iraq, not because the U.S. military is underfunded or poorly trained or anything like that, but because as awesome as its firepower is, America has not demonstrated to the world a willingness to deploy the other elements of national power. You know, if you think back to September the 11th, on September the 12th, 2001, the Pakistani government took a phone call from Richard Armitage, who was one of the most notorious doves at Colin Powell's State Department. And he lays out what he expects from the Pakistani government, and they're, you know, not happy about it. And he says to them, "And if we don't get it, we're going to bomb you back to the Stone Age." General Musharraf, in his book, is very funny about this. General Musharraf's book is actually a book worth reading. He has the coolest opening chapter of any book I've ever read, any biography I've ever read. He just reminisces about the different attempts on his life for like 30 pages, which is... So he's like a tough guy. He's a tough guy. He's not the guy who normally caves. But he caved instantly on this because he understood that Richard Armitage, who isn't a tough guy, meant it. Same thing with the Russians. The Americans decided they needed certain old Soviet bases in Central Asia. Very politically difficult for the Russians, which still looks on Uzbekistan, Tajikistan as their turf. But the Russians caved in because they knew America was serious. What's the difference? It's not that we had the Maxim gun. It's that very unusually, after and almost freakishly, after 10 years of kind of being mired in multilateral passivity, America suddenly, General Musharraf and Moscow realized that America was serious about using the Maxim gun in its national interest. Well, 5 years on, that's all changed. Bashar Assad is a weak enemy. He's been getting away with murder on a huge scale in Iraq, and yet he doesn't have to worry about sleepless nights in his palace in Damascus. He had a few in the spring of 2003. He's not having them now. So that, as I said, is the pompous answer to why I wrote the book. I really want to change the terms in which we think of the war on terror as part of a global struggle in which we are starting and playing on the worst turf. We're playing on turf that causes us, that requires us, to end our assumptions about, for example, population growth, to end our assumptions about multiculturalism, to end our assumption on a range of things that are forced down the throats of our children in every kindergarten across the Western world. That's a huge thing. No matter how many guns and nuclear weapons we have, it's not going to make any difference unless we win on that turf too. And the less pompous answer to why I changed, I wrote the book, is because I object to what I think of as the Larry King school of foreign policy. I hasten to add, I'm not thinking of Larry when he says, tonight, Anne Margaret for the full hour. Tonight, Dick Van Dyke for the full hour. Carol Channing for the full hour. I love that side of Larry King. The problem is on nights like tonight, when the president is giving an address, and afterwards it's usually followed by Larry with a panel of six senators and ex-secretaries of state discussing the speech. And the difficulty is that they're exactly like his stroll down memory lane with Dick Van Dyke and Carol Channing. It's distinguished old people reminiscing about other distinguished old people. On his political panels, Larry interviews great men about what needs to be done, and the great men all agree that, you know, what needs to be done is that the president needs to get other great men involved to, quote, broker a deal. I remember seeing one around the time of the Israel-Hezbollah thing, and Senator Chuck Hagel said that the answer to this Israel-Hezbollah war was that Bush needed to appoint Colin Powell or Jim Baker as his special envoy. And then Senator Barbara Boxer comes on and said, no, that's not what's needed. Bush needs to appoint Madeleine Albright as his even more special envoy. Former Senator George Mitchell, who always seems to be an envoy somewhere or other around the world. You know, you can take a vacation and you'll turn up in Latvia or Chad, and George Mitchell will be there as a special envoy sorting out what's ever going on around there. They've been doing it for decades. Nothing seems to happen, but it doesn't seem his envoy career is a model. He's probably teaching a course in how to be a special envoy at Harvard. He said that no, this was, it wasn't enough just to appoint Madeleine Albright. Bush needed to meet with the leaders of the European Union because, of course, they have such great influence at advancing American foreign policy goals in the Middle East. And then someone else proposed an emergency meeting of the G8. And all this is complete nonsense because if those guys really believe that, we are in deep trouble. The most important feature of the world today is not the great men. You learn nothing about Jordan by flying in and meeting with King Abdullah, because King Abdullah does not speak for the people of Jordan. And you learn nothing about Saudi Arabia by going in and receiving assurances from their King Abdullah. And you learn nothing about Egypt from going in, flying into Cairo and speaking to President Mubarak. They do not speak for their peoples. And it's the non-entities who make the difference. The guys who can never in their life get on a Larry King panel. They are the ones who make the difference in the world today. These millions and millions of Muslim young men being pumped out in lands with no economic opportunity, no education. The most salient fact about the Palestinian question is this, that the mean age in the Gaza Strip is 15.8 years. Now, you look like a prosperous crowd. I'm sure you all live in nice neighborhoods with low crime. You may live, like me, I live in a picture-perfect New England small town. Looks great on postcards. But even if you live in beautiful parts of the world with no crime, you know that the little crime there is in your part of the world is generally caused, if somebody steals some beers from the convenience store, it's caused by fellas in their late teens, early 20s. If you preside over a nation, or even a pseudo-nation like Palestine, of teenage boys, what sense are you going to get out of them? You can't send Jim Baker in to a population of 15-year-old punks, because they don't look at the world the way Jim Baker does. And I think that is the real problem, that if you don't address the demography here, you don't really understand what's going on. You know, those guys from Yemen and Pakistan and Gaza, they're moving to Western nations. They're moving to European nations. And my book is really the antidote, I think, to Larry King panels. I think it understands that those anonymous people, those millions and millions of anonymous young men, guys raised in a death cult, guys raised at Pakistani madrasas, going to Europe and discovering that although they live there, and again, this is where the economic argument, I think, is insufficient. Economists, when the guy from the Pakistani madrasa lands at the airport, they think, well, he's coming here to do the jobs Americans won't do. They see him as the convenience store clerk. They see him as a plumber. He doesn't see himself as that. He's being a plumber to advance his other interests. And the reality is that a significant proportion of those people, their pan-Islamist identity is their core identity. It spreads across borders with ease, and it has a greater pull on them than the passports they carry in their pockets. They think of themselves as Islamic rather than as Belgian or as Dutch or as Canadian. And I'll just close with what I think is the most important fact in my book. It's right there up at the front, but I don't think the Jim Baker crowd thinks about this. In 1970, the developed world represented just under 30% of the global population, and the Muslim world 15%. By 2000, the developed world's share of the global population had fallen to just over 20%, and the Muslim world had increased to 20%. In other words, in 1970, the developed nations had twice a bigger share of the global population as the Muslim world, 30% to 15%. By 2000, they were at parity, each at 20%. And that's why whenever you hear any of these so-called foreign policy realists talk about stability, you should hoot and jeer, because there's no such thing as stability, only the illusion of stability, like the Connecticut River in my part of the world when it ices over this time of year. Underneath the ice, the water's still moving. The unreal, real politique crowd think that you can ring-fence a problem, you can contain it. But under the veneer of containment, history is still on the march. And if it's not moving in your direction, then chances are it's going in the other fellas. It's moving very fast right now and not in our direction. 1970 doesn't seem terribly long ago. In fact, if you look at the Larry King guest list, it would seem like 1970. It's Anne Margaret, Dick Van Dyke, Jimmy Carter, James Baker, Zbigniew Brzezinski, Tina Louise. They're all there. It's unchanged. But in fact, the world has completely altered. And if you look at those statistics and then nudge it on a bit, what will those numbers look like in 2020, 2030? We won't even be able to do them. We won't even be able to say, well, the developed world's fallen to 12%, the Muslim world's population has increased to 28%, because by 2030, much of what we think of as the developed world will be part of the Muslim world. And that is why it behoves America, which has stronger advantages than any of the other countries that we think of as part of the West. Because the big difference is, for America, this is a conventional war. You go to faraway places, you kill foreigners. In Europe, it's a civil war. It's subjects of the Queen who blow up the London Tube. It's citoyens de la République Française who riot and burn and torch the cities of France every night. It's a civil war for them. And so we have to understand that the planet is changing very fast, and that America needs to use its moment now, or we really will face a new dark ages. Thank you.
Mark, I think, would you be able to stay and answer some questions?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, great. So you don't get off the hook that easily then, right? I can tell you from my reading of the book, there's so much more to it than Mark was able to touch on today, so you really should do yourself the favor, if you haven't already, to get a copy and read through it. And there's some questions that I would like to ask you in deference to the group here. Why don't you all go ahead and you can just take questions on your own, and I'll step up when it's time to go.
Okay. Yes, the lady at the front.
Yes, thank you. Haley Dale, Heritage Foundation, reader of your book. It's terrific. You take your place in a long, distinguished line of people who have predicted the decline of the West. Now, I'm sure I'd agree with you that this time it's for real, but still, you must have given this some thought as you were writing. Whether the decline of the West, as we've seen it and has been written about over the past 100 years, is this a chapter in it, or is this a different phenomenon altogether, or are we in for a revival of the West perhaps at some point?
Well, I think it is part of a continuum. You know, if I wanted to do a big kind of overview of it, I would say, and I think, by the way, we should distinguish between the what we mean when we talk about the West, because it's true that, you know, if you say to yourself, well, what's the big deal about losing Germany and Italy, and these countries have all done terrible things. It's true. Spain, Portugal, Greece were dictatorships a generation ago. You go back a generation before that, and Germany and France and Italy were dictatorships. And you can say, well, what do these guys have to teach the rest of the planet anyway? They've very clearly failed at a certain level as nation states for most of modern history. So I always distinguish between what I would call the cultural West. You know, that Goethe and Beethoven and Mozart and Michelangelo's David. They are part of our inheritance. But I have a slight, in terms of the political West, the countries that have created the institutions by which this planet operates, the global economy operates, by which make it possible for me as a writer, for example, to enforce my copyrights in most parts of the world, that derives from a narrower Anglo-American tradition, and that is now in danger. I think if you talk about the West in general terms, in the Battle of the Somme in 1916 on the First World War, the carnage of the First World War, the slaughter, I think the ruling classes of Europe felt they lost their moral authority, and they never recovered it. And a kind of infection took hold in which a kind of elite self-loathing percolated ever further down in society. And I think that indirectly gave rise to a lot of the features we see in our world today, where we have a successful standard of living. We have better health care, longer life expectancy, greater range of economic opportunities than any other people in human history. And yet if you go to the typical grade school in this country, you're taught that it's all terribly wicked and it was accomplished by doing terrible things to terrible people. And I think that I think in a sense the sort of metastasized self-loathing that we face today has its roots really, I think, in the First World War and a kind of crisis of confidence from which those ruling classes never really recovered. Yes, the lady in the center there.
Hi, my name is Deborah Weiss, and I'm a fellow with the Center for Security Policy and a 9/11 survivor from the World Trade Center attacks. My question is, how can we make CEOs of companies like Burger King and Nike understand that there are values more important than whether or not they lose a few dollars from Muslim customers, since they've been caving in every time Muslim front groups pressure them to, with, you know, change the little sign on their product that, you know, if you stand on your head with your leg wrapped behind your ear, it sort of looks like the word Allah. And then they just seem to cave in on everything. And what can we do about that?
Well, I think, in fairness to them, that it's not an economic thing. If you're being boycotted, I believe the Baptists, the Southern Baptists, have been boycotting Disney for, Disney did some film about a gay priest, I think, in 1994. And the Southern Baptists boycotted them for years afterwards. And it made no difference. Disney didn't care. It's not an economic issue. The guy at Burger King, if he leaves the swirl that if you crane your neck and stand on your head looks a bit like Allah, the word, he's scared that there are going to be people waiting outside Burger King who will kill him and kill his employees, you know, and that the whole site is... I was up in my part of New Hampshire, an 85-year-old granny put her foot on the wrong pedal and drove through McDonald's in Woodsville, New Hampshire. They're flimsy buildings. You lean on them there, you go through them. But the carnage, this granny driving through it, there was like burger patties hanging everywhere. It was like a horrific sight. And I think that's what the Burger King guy is picturing when he has a dispute with an aggrieved Muslim customer. And so I think that's not something that Burger King and Nike can stand against, because if you threaten to kill someone, you will get taken seriously. And that's the difference between Catholics protesting the play about Jesus being gay that was on Broadway a couple of years ago, and these Mohammedans protesting the cartoons. Because the Muslims, when they say behead the enemies of Islam, these guys think they mean it. When the Catholics boycott a play, who cares? And so you have to make that clear, and that's where the media comes in. You know, we in the media, we talk about our courage all the time. Talk about the courage all the time. The cartoons offered an opportunity to show some courage. These cartoonist kids in Copenhagen, they're getting threatened in their schoolyards by these fellows. And we should have said, look, this newspaper, none of us has ever heard about it, but we're going to publish the cartoons in the New York Times and Le Monde and the Sydney Morning Herald and the Times of London and the Times of India. We're going to publish these newspapers in every paper, these cartoons in every newspaper in the world. And if you want to kill us, you're going to have to kill us all. We talk in the media about our courage all the time. Here was an opportunity to show some, and we didn't. And so I think we, in a sense, are partly responsible for creating the climate of intimidation in which the lights go out on free speech every week now. I'm proud to say my publishers at Regnery publish this book. They publish a lot of books on this issue. Every week I hear from publishers in London, publishers in Sydney, publishers in Paris, about these guys turning down French, British, Australian authors writing about this subject because those publishers are scared to publish. And that's how the lamps go out all over the world one by one. Yes, down here.
Good afternoon, Mr. Steyn. My name is Damon Pace. Just a huge fan of your books and commentary. being familiar with your writings and with your book, what makes you optimistic that the United States will prevail against radical Islam? Here in this country, the Democratic majority, of course, is in power, along with the multicultural mindset. Many Americans do appear to be tiring of the war and want to withdraw from that region. In addition, in my opinion, the secularist agenda does seem to be rising. Many of the same conditions that exist in Europe already. With that being said, what makes you optimistic that America will not have the same fate as certain European countries?
Well, I'm not optimistic. I don't think this nation should be a 50-50 nation, because essentially the Democratic Party is the European Party. It wants to embrace at an economic level, ideally, I mean it has to be cautious about it, but it sees the natural destination of the advanced Western democracy as being a lot closer to Sweden than to Mississippi. And I think if America got closer to Sweden than to Mississippi, then we would find ourselves in the same dreadful situation that the Europeans are in. So I'm not optimistic. This shouldn't be a 50 nation. And you're right to say that, you know, in a sense, it's not really about just going and voting for some guy according to what letter he has after his name every other November. that if you exist in a society where all the most influential levers in that society are wielded by the same cultural relativists that have basically plunged Europe over the waterfall, you have to do something about it there. You do have to start in the kindergartens and with the movie. You can't just complain. We on the right complain about movies a lot. We should actually just make other movies. We should recognize the entry levels are different now. You don't have to be Paramount or Warner Brothers anymore. You should just get on with it and make better stories. I'm astonished, the difference now. I mean, I mentioned professors in. Professors have always been crazy. They were crazy in the 1930s. But what's worrying is that back then in the 1930s, the professor may have been crazy, but the little nice village schoolmarm with her hair in a bun, she had her marbles. Well, now the village schoolmarm with her hair in the bun doesn't have her marbles. And so we have to recognize that you can't just do it on a kind of Republican-Democrat basis. You've got to actually make a difference in all those other institutions, or we will be in the same situation. Yes, the gentleman up there.
Hi, my name is Damian Harvey. I'm a producer with Capital Pictures here in Washington. My question goes back to the one previous to the last one asked, and I think that the absence of imams and other Islamic leaders protesting against the violence that's being carried out by Muslims worldwide is conspicuous by its absence. And I'm wondering if you could talk about that.
Yes, I think that's true. I think that's because I think I say in the book at some point that there are millions of moderate, so-called moderate Muslims, that's to say Muslims who just want to get on with their lives. But they get no support for that moderation from any school of Islam. Every school of Islam is basically at its core jihadist. You know, Islam is a very problematic religion. It's much closer to a conventional imperial project than it is to what we regard as religion. And that's one of the mistakes. When we hear that there's a mosque opening up on Main Street, we think, well, it's a religion. So we're thinking of like a congregational church or something like that. And it's not. It's actually something far more explicitly political. And most of the surveys that have been done, the Mounties did one up in Canada, and they concluded that some 85% of imams in Canadian mosques were hardcore radical jihadists. I believe a similar survey was done down here, and it was reassuringly lower. It was about 80%. So clearly the broad Muslim population is actually more moderate than their imams. And I think that is the great problem, is that all the lobby groups, all the imams, are actually very, very extreme and have great, what we would call great scriptural authority for their extremism. I would say, in fact, that we are turning into moderate Muslims. We are becoming moderate Muslims. That, in fact, the host communities in most Western nations are developing the same quiescent attitudes to this subject that the moderate Muslims have. Keep your head down. It's better not to publish the book on this subject. It's better not to do the TV show on this subject. Or it's better to actually suck up to these guys. They've just started in Canada last night. They did the first episode of a new sitcom called Little Mosque on the Prairie. And it's about a small town out in the prairies that's got a Muslim community. And what is the core joke of this show? It's that the white folks in that town are like dumb, ignorant rednecks who are stupid enough to think that every Muslim is an extremist and a terrorist. And the Muslims function like the gay characters do on American sitcoms. The Muslim is the new gay. And that's off the record because I want to get back to New Hampshire alive. But Muslim is the new gay in the sense that the gays, if you watch a sitcom here, the gay guy, the gay best friend says all the brittle, the principals are neurotic, they can't handle it, and the gay, witty, brittle gay guy says all the charming, amusing, sophisticated things. And that's how in Little Mosque on the Prairie, the rednecks are all neurotic and paranoid, and it's the Muslim people who say all the brittle, witty, sophisticated, amusing things. And so I think that I would be surprised if it takes takes off there, I wouldn't be surprised if somebody does that kind. There'll be a Muslim best friend in a sitcom here before too long. If I was gay, if I was one of the gay guys, I'd be annoyed with this because it means they're moving, you know, they're moving into the role of the Darren character in Bewitched. You know, they're going to be. Now I'm sounding like Larry King again. Let's say.
Hi, Patrick Abbin with the Washington Examiner. In President Bush's speech tonight, given the current political climate, he's probably going to have to play it a little bit safe down the middle of the road, which strikes me as not in keeping with your proposition to really show your guns, show that you mean business. So if you were to write his speech tonight, what would sort of be your money quote? What would be the main message? What would be in the newspaper headlines tomorrow morning?
Well, I think he needs to slap down. I think the problem in Iraq is basically a problem in America. You know, in the end, it's true. You can't, nobody can give freedom to people in Iraq. But we can certainly do our best to facilitate the conditions in which Iraq can be better than most other countries in the Arab world. Is that a project in the U.S. interest? Yes, it is. Because at the moment, in the repression that's in the Muslim world, and in the Arab world in particular, the only political space is within the mosques. So if you are a dissenter in most parts of the Arab world, you become a jihadist. America should say, this is a tough, President Bush should say, we are trying to do a tough job in Iraq. We are trying to buck 1,000 years of history. We are trying to do something that every European power at the height of imperialism avoided. They sailed around the Middle East. They brought Western values to the Indian subcontinent and to Australia and the Pacific and to the Americas and the Caribbean, but they sailed round the Middle East. And it is unfortunately on America's watch that we have to do the job they bucked centuries ago. Is it tough? Yes. But is there an alternative? No. Because American credibility is on the line. Because our enemies understand that the war in Iraq is not about Iraq, it's about America. Iran turns out to be funding both sides of the so-called civil war in Iraq. It's funding the Sunni and it's funding the Shia. Why would it be doing that? Because it's basically staging an ersatz dinner theater civil war for the benefit of American TV. Because it knows that the object is to make America weak, to make America scuttle and run, and essentially to cow Americans into running away. It's been a long time since this country unambiguously won a war. It's been 60 years, apart from pipsqueak things like Grenada. The question before Americans is Vietnam an aberration or is it part of a pattern? Because if it's part of a pattern, you're done for. You can't be a rich, prosperous country and keep losing wars and expect to stay prosperous and powerful and advanced. You simply can't. Not going to happen. Nobody would take America seriously if America retreated from Iraq. Why would they? Why, you know, not Russia, not China. Why would Belgium take America seriously? If it was sitting across the table in trade negotiations, what's America going to threaten? You know, the thing is, in the end, if you're interested in talking about different ways to victory, then fine, we can have a disagreement about that. If, like Ted Kennedy, you say there's no possibility of victory, there's never going to be a possibility of victory, there's no victory, then sorry, you're not part of the conversation. You can't be part of the conversation. And President Bush needs to take it to those guys, those defeatism, and say, look, you want defeat. That's your right. That's your right to argue for defeat. But America, under my administration, is not looking for the best way to lose. He needs to get tough, not just on Iran and Syria and the insurgents. He needs to get tough on the losers here in his own country.
Thank you, Mark, and thanks everyone here. Mark Steyn is offered to actually sign some books out front, so if we'll just take a moment to let him get out there, and there'll be maybe 10 minutes that he has more with us today. But once again, everybody, please join me in the Heritage Foundation in thanking Mark Steyn for joining us.